Hey guys, greetings. Mark Boswell here with Boswell Emergency Medical. Just out and about today and realized I hadn't really done a video in a while for you guys with some little test taking pointers for the CEN exam. So I had a question the other day by email. Someone was asking about what drugs they needed to study for the CEN exam. And I get that question occasionally. We do talk about it in the class, and I tell people they need to know about drugs and such. So I'm going to share it with you guys here today. So drugs for the CEN, it is pretty straightforward, simple. There's not a lot of, let me take it back. You'll need to know some drug names, but one, you don't need to go and learn new drug names. I'll get to that in a moment. And two, as far as dosages, there's not many that are a universal standardized dose that you have to memorize the exam, okay? So let me go back to number one, drug names. Now, on the exam, what you'll see is you'll see a drug brand name, and then in parentheses, you'll see the generic name. So for example, if Phenergan is there, you'll see Phenergan, and then you'll see in parentheses, promethazine. If you see Rocephin, you'll see Rocephin, and then parentheses, ceftriaxone. So the ENA, or the BCEN rather, the exam administrators and the exam authors, they know that as healthcare workers, we do a lot of work using brand names for drugs. And let's face it, that's why drug companies spend millions of dollars developing these brand names so they're easy to remember and you use their product, okay? There's other makers of Phenergan. There's other makers of promethazine, but they call it by a different name, okay? Same thing with Rocephin maybe, I don't know. But so the ENA recognizes this, and remember, this test is not about mental gymnastics. This test is about testing your cognitive knowledge, okay? This test is not testing on drug names, okay? So if there's a question and there's some drug in it, or the drug is the question or whatever, you'll see the brand name, which is most commonly accepted, okay, which most of us, I'm gonna say 80% of us know that common brand name. But then to protect themselves, the ENA will give you that generic name also, because the company that makes Phenergan, if there's another company that makes promethazine also, they're gonna get upset and say, hey, Mr. BCEN exam author, why are you using the word Phenergan on your test? That's unfair to me, because I make a version of Phenergan also, but you're spreading that name out to all these thousands of ER nurses, and you're like marketing for them, because you're exposing nurses to that name. Well, the ENA knows that most of us use Phenergan, that common brand name. But to be fair, they're also going to put it in parentheses in with the generic name. So yeah, they do kind of acknowledge that we use those brand names a lot, but they're also being fair and in addressing the concerns about, you know, marketing and advertising by giving the generic name also. Now, for those of you in the military or working for the VA or the Department of Defense, all you use is brand names. I'm sorry, generic names. You know, that's one of those things with the federal government, they can't play favorite to a particular vendor or not. So you're probably familiar saying promethazine if you work in the VA often. You're probably comfortable saying furosemide more than you do Lasix if you work for the military or the DOD. So that's the nuts and bolts as far as drug names. I've heard of students going out and working on drug cards and memorizing drug names before the test. Do not do that. You're not going to get a lot of useful information for your time by doing that. Okay, you're going to know one of these two drug names already. And then you've got your other clues about drug names. You remember from nursing school, other pharmacology classes, some general assumptions about drug names. If it ends in LOL, it's probably what? A beta blocker. Okay. If it ends in PRIL, PRIL, ACE inhibitor. Okay, those are just some common examples, okay? And those rules are still true. So you've already got this knowledge base. Please don't go and spend time trying to memorize drug names, okay? Dosages, so this is not a big issue either, okay? Think about your clinical site. Think about where you work and the providers, the mid-levels you work with. And think about dosages, about ranges of dosages. You know, your one physician on Monday may order 25 of Phenergan, and then on Tuesdays he orders 50 of Phenergan, all right? Or, you know, something else. On one day of the week, they order half a milligram of Ativan, the other day they ordered a full milligram. So there's no absolute dose for most drugs. It's a clinician discretion, and there's usually a range of dosing, okay? Now, that being said, there's only one that comes to mind that is frequently tested on, which is a standard, which is from your ACLS stuff, okay? And specifically the one I need you to memorize is the peds epinephrine dosing, okay? It's the same for peds and it's the same for newborns or infants, okay? And that is 0.01 milligrams per kilo IV or IM. Another way to say that is 1/100th of a milligram IV or IM for peds or infants, okay? Why do I say that? Because pretty much epi is the go-to drug during most of our resuscitations these days, and so that's probably going to be asked about, or definitely fair game. You know, your adult dose of epi from ACLS is 1 milligram. That does not change. That's the current AHA recommendations, okay? But for peds, a lot of us don't do peds or PALs, so 1/100th of a milligram per kilo. I'd say you at least need to know that and be comfortable being able to memorize that one, okay? But there's not many others out there. During the whole two-day class I do, that epi dose is the only one we go over. The other ones that are pretty much standard and locked in are your other ALS meds, okay? So like for your adult resuscitation, mentioned your 1 milligram of epi is a standard, your 1 milligram of atropine is a standard for symptomatic bradycardia, your amiodarone, 300 milligrams for that first IV push for pulses VTAC or VFib, and the second dose is 150, and so on and so forth. Those are about the only dosages I want you to memorize or spend your time on this exam, okay? And again, it's just because the ENA knows that there's physician or provider differences on all the other stuff. Like, you know, this week we may be given Rocephin 125 IM for gonorrhea. Next week we may be given Rocephin 250 for gonorrhea, okay? So hopefully that helps you. So again, just to recap quickly those two things. One, do not go memorize new drug names. You already know what you need to know for the test. Two, be familiar with some of those family names for drugs. Again, like I use the beta blockers commonly, the LOL, and the ACE inhibitors, the PRILs, like enalapril and lisinopril. And then three, don't stress about dosages with the exception of your ALS dosages. And if you're not familiar with your couple PALS ones, go ahead and know those, okay? And definitely the epi. If there's any PALS ALS drug that's gonna be asked about, it will be the epi, because every PALS resuscitation, if it gets to the point of giving drugs, it's gonna be at least epi, okay? So I hope that helps. I'm gonna post this online here in just a little bit. Sorry about the bright sun in the back of the video, but sunset this evening time here in South Carolina. And I'll be talking to you guys again soon. A couple classes coming up. Going to Kansas City, Montgomery, Alabama, and Anderson, Indiana pretty soon, so I'll be busy the next 2 weeks. Keep watching Facebook for the practice questions and other study aids, and I will talk to you guys later. Be safe, take care, bye-bye.